Hello, everybody. I'm going to talk about the Tower of Babel of the modern age, which we discovered on the Bumbu Street of the Ley City in Papua New Guinea, on the tropical island of New Guinea. This is a secondary school where students are speaking 126 different languages. You can see them coming out of the classrooms and receiving English-written Bibles and excitedly waving them in the air. And that contrast between the language diversity and the literature they are reading perhaps exemplifies best the contradiction between the past and future of extreme language and cultural diversity, which will be a broader topic of this talk based on the work we have done together with Alfred Kick and other colleagues in Papua New Guinea. So this Ley Secondary School, where we have done our surveys, has 381 students in the last two grades, 11 and 12, and they indeed speak 126 different languages. So that means that if we pick up randomly any two students, then the chances that they speak the same language is just 2 out of 100. When we ask them also about their best friends in school, then only 16% of them had their best friend speaking the same language. We are talking about the local indigenous languages. At the same time, there is a Creole lingua franca, Tok Pisin or Melanesian Pidgin English, which is used as a widespread language of communication. And also there is English, and that is used for the teaching at the school. So in the broader context, the school is located on the island of New Guinea, which is a global hotspot of language and cultural diversity. You can see the map with individual languages shown there. And there are about 11 million people speaking about 1,000 different languages. So that means that the linguistic diversity is approximately 100 times higher than you would expect based on the population. I will be talking mostly about the eastern part of the island, which is the independent country of Papua New Guinea. Here you can see it superimposed on the European map for the sense of the size of the country. That huge language diversity just surprises visitors everywhere. This is, for instance, our field course of biology for a mix of European and Papua New Guinea students. And when this small group was asked to mark their toilets as male and female, then you can see that we have received quite a complex list of expressions. Papua New Guinea and New Guinea overall is diverse not only in terms of number of languages, but also higher classifications. There are at least 21 different families of New Guinea languages on the level of Indo-European family, where most of the Europe, for instance, belong. There are two interesting units. One are Trans-New Guinea languages, which are in gray on the map, and there has been indeed a very fast explosive speciation of languages from that group. So they represent the largest number of languages. There are a number of smaller or larger isolates or families, often of obscure position, especially in the northern part of the country. And then in the dark blue, there are Austronesian languages, which represent a second, much more recent wave of colonization. All this diversity is, of course, relatively recent, especially for biologists thinking about the biological diversity, which is typically millions of years old, while here we are talking about the language diversity that was generated over the last 60,000 years since the colonization of New Guinea. That's where most of the diversity comes from, and then the later arrivals were a minority of languages. It's not only the number of languages, but also the fact that there is not a single language in Papua New Guinea, which represents more than 5% of population. This quantitative relationship between languages can be measured by so-called Greenberg's Language Diversity Index. Those who are biologists know Simpson's Species Diversity Index, where instead of languages, we measure distribution of species. The formula is exactly the same. It's an example of a parallel thinking in two different disciplines. And the interpretation of the index ranging from 0 to 1 is that it's a probability that a randomly chosen compatriot speaks a different language than you. So when we look at selected countries, Papua New Guinea is number one and has the Greenberg's value 0.988. So that means that there is about 1% chance that there will be somebody randomly selected from the New Guinea population that will speak the same language as you. So we can liken that to dialing a random mobile phone number, and so you would have to dial 100 times before getting somebody that can understand you. That just shows the sheer impracticality of these legacy cultural and language diversity for the modern functioning of the country. Also, there are about 7,000 languages globally. So when we are thinking which language is large and small, that can be quite, our feeling can be quite misleading. This is the top 1% of the largest languages. And that group ends with Fulu, which is spoken by 14.5 million people. So that is still a language in Africa, which belongs to the top 1% in terms of size, which of course starts with Mandarin Chinese. This is the global distribution of 7,000 extant languages. And clearly we can see that there is a tropical maximum. That's generally bad news because it's very difficult to explain any kind of latitudinal maxima because there are so many different factors which are changing with latitude. Biologists again know that very well because interestingly biological diversity has the same latitudinal maximum as language diversity. We can, of course, try a lot of explanatory factors, some of them quite entertaining. For instance, when we plot the language density against the amount of rainfall which is falling in that region, we get a very nice correlation. So the more it rains, the more different languages there are for people to communicate with. I'm pretty sure that evapotranspiration, which works very nicely for species diversity, would also predict languages even better. But more seriously, we can actually look at different geographical parameters and explore their relationship with languages. There has been shown a direct effect of latitude, also the mean vegetation growing season. The longer the season, the more languages. And then aspects of geography which contribute to isolation. So river density and the range of elevations in the countryside are positively correlated with language diversity. When we fit these existing trends, then we still get anomalies, the high diversity areas of languages, which should not be there based on the how the landscape looks like. And there are four of them, one in Mexico, another in West Africa, foothills of the Himalayan mountains, and the island of New Guinea. We can also see a cold spot, that means a low diversity in the Amazon and the Andes, which is in contrast with extremely high biological diversity, which is there. But when we look at the broader picture, how can we explain generators of language diversity? The explanations fall typically to four different classes. One is already described geographic isolation. So there is a physical separation of people, which leads to their cultural and language separation. Then there is a social fragmentation. People don't need mountains to isolate themselves. And so that might be another factor. Sometimes people don't have to get isolated, but they just have no good reason to move. And so they stay put and can happily diversify. So that's a theory about a low dispersal in stable productive environment. So for instance, these are sweet potato gardens in the highlands of New Guinea, which had several crops a year, and there is very little seasonality of the climate, and so people can produce their staple food all year round and don't really have to think about migration anywhere. Movement can also be biologically risky. This is perhaps now very well understood with the COVID epidemics, which spread globally because of the movements of people. So another expectation is that the more you move, the more you get exposed to pathogens, parasites, and other harmful biodiversity. And so there is, for instance, a nice correlation between the density of infectious diseases and density of languages. The problem is that with any phenomenon which is showing latitudinal trends from the temperate to tropical zone, you can generate a lot of these nice correlations. For instance, if we used the number of species of butterflies instead of diseases, we would get equally nice correlation. So going to individual factors, elevation. It does not necessarily have to be the case that mountains have higher density of languages than the lowlands. That can be shown in Papua New Guinea. These are languages, different shades show different elevation. So there is the highlands in the middle. And since languages are distributed as a mosaic, so they are locally exclusive, with some simplification, then we can simply see whether the size of the language, the area it occupies, is changing with elevation. And as we have shown, it does not. So the languages are not more diverse in New Guinea mountains than in the lowland areas. With these different language densities at different elevations, we can actually model how many languages there would be on the island of New Guinea under different geography. So this is the current situation for Papua New Guinea, only about 800 languages. If we use the lowland density of languages, we will get slightly lower numbers for a completely lowland island. Then if we only have elevations above 500 meters, we get this density of languages, and the completely mountainous New Guinea would again produce something around 800 languages. So overall, geography does not really have a big impact on New Guinea. It might be because highlands are isolating people physically, but lowlands are isolating them biologically, because in the lowlands there is a large risk of malaria, actually the highest outside of Africa. And malaria is responding to population density. And so it can spread, especially in high density populations, then it increases the mortality, and that means the population density goes down again. So it's possible that especially historically, malaria was a controlling factor, isolating individual populations at wide distances in the lowlands. The legacy of that is a very strange settlement pattern in New Guinea, where the population density is very low in the lowlands, below 5 people per square kilometer, while the peak of the density is in the malaria-free highlands at about 1700 meters. That means completely opposite pattern of what we know, for instance, from European settlement. Now, as we already discussed, people don't really need physical features of the landscape to isolate themselves. There is a lot of social mechanisms, especially fighting, which serves the same purpose. And so the question is whether that might be the main isolating factor and generator of cultural diversity. And it looks indeed that the tribal societies are violent, and they have the tendency to fragment and be hostile with their neighbors. There is a rather absurd controversy about this. Some people and NGOs like Survival International feel like this is reflecting badly on tribal people, but in fact, I think this is simply the patterns we observe as scientists, and we have to deal with them. This has been well documented in one of the best known anthropology account of tribal people, Yanomamo, by Napoleon Chagnon, who is one of the scientists on sort of blacklist of these NGOs, because his book on Yanomamo had the subtitle "The Fierce People," and the controversy did not change his scientific conclusions, but you can see that it did change the editorial policy of his book, because these are six consecutive editions of the book, and the subtitle "The Fierce People" survived only in the first three of them. Then the next two editions at least had a fairly belligerent photograph on the title, while the current latest sixth edition makes Yanomamo into metrosexuals. The Napoleon Chagnon book also was followed by a very interesting account of both tribal communities and scientific communities, with the subtitle "The Noble Savages," with the subtitle "On the Life Among Two Dangerous Tribes, the Yanomamo and the Anthropologists." And it's a really fascinating account of social dynamics of anthropology as a scientific discipline as well. Another scientist on the blacklist is Jared Diamond, and there I would especially recommend his book "The World Until Yesterday," which is basically a comparative analysis of different tribal populations across the world. This is something which biologists do all the time, while in anthropology it's more usual to have a detailed survey of a single tribe, but this is actually very valuable comparative analysis, and again shows a strong tendency towards violence and social fragmenting in tribal communities. When thinking about this, especially about the more ancient history of human civilization, we need to sort of expand our frame of thinking to the phylogeny of people. And so what is the legacy of us being mammals and us being primates in terms of violence? There is an extremely interesting paper published by Gomez in Nature, which is addressing just that. The advantage is that the violence is very easily quantifiable across different species. We simply look at the murder rate and the percentage of population killed by conspecific individuals. And that is usually pretty well measurable. And from that, we can see that our relatives, primates, are some of the worst among mammals. And then, you know, how nicely would humans get along if we behaved like bats do, for instance, with very little violence and murder rate. But being primates as we are, we can expect about 2% of mortality due to murders. And that's pretty much what is documented in the historic tribal societies, and the current tribal societies typically also have a higher level of violence than the states. So despite all the huge wars, the state is actually a device to reduce violence as opposed to the tribal societies. In Papua New Guinea, Papua New Guinea is a functioning or reasonably functioning democracy, but at the same time there are still signature of the tribal life, which is going along other features of the society from the past. And so there are tribal hostilities, unfortunately, also combining with modern weaponry. And so there has been, for instance, a very serious epidemic of violence, which was caused by using modern guns adopted to the old patterns of tribal conflict. And then there was an epidemic of hostilities with serious statistics of 250 conflicts with 5,000 fatalities per 500,000 people in the 25 years, and so that's a quite serious mortality. But interestingly, the societal reconciliation mechanisms reduce this critical situation, so that the increase of casualties per conflict, which skyrocketed compared to pre-colonial level, went down again. There is a very good analysis on the social mechanisms by Wiesner and Pupu, published in Science, about anger. However, there are certain signs of higher standards of violence which survive until today. This is still documentary from Enga, Los Rambos, about fighters for hire, again a new phenomenon. Now, violent interactions with neighbors, which we have seen in lots of tribal societies, also have genetic consequences. So again, in Papua New Guinea, there has been a recent study 4 years ago about the differences in the genetic makeup between different tribal communities in the highlands, which are in blue here, and then in the lowlands. It has to be said that highlands have been only recently contacted by colonial powers, and so the situation there hasn't really diverged by mixing of people too much from the tribal state of situation. And there was indeed a very clear correlation between the distance of the tribal communities and their genetic differences, and there was also much higher difference between genetic makeup of the lowlanders and the highlanders. When we put these values of divergence into context, then we can see that the difference between New Guinea lowlands and highlands is on the same level as, for instance, between British and Sri Lankans, while at the same time the difference inside of the highlands between tribes 50 to 200 kilometers apart is on the level of the largest differences in Europe between Finnish and Spanish people, or in Asia between, for instance, Japanese and Vietnamese. So there are enormous genetic differences on a small scale in New Guinea, which again are most likely due to social fragmentation, because they apply to both lowlanders and the highlanders. By the way, the highlands is the fascinating area of the last first contact between civilizations in human history, where the entire highlands with more than 1 million people living there were first contacted in 1930s, and so less than 100 years ago. And some more remote areas much more recently, after the Second World War. So, for instance, grandmother of one of my colleagues in Papua New Guinea was already married when her village was first contacted by outside world, and they learned that there is something there is something like ocean in existence, and then there are actually quite a number of tribes across the New Guinea, not only their immediate neighbors they knew about. So this footprint of the tribal societies is also manifesting in the high language diversity in New Guinea. Speaking more about this fragmentation, how it works? Well, we know that there is a limited capacity of individual people to socialize in detail with other people. So, of course, our mental processing capacity is limited, and there is a suggestion that it might be about 150 people with whom we can deal meaningfully. That means that we know them in detail, we know what to expect, we know how to control them. And so that so-called Dunbar's number, and that would correspond to the level which can be managed politically without any structures in place. And that's exactly what happens in Papua New Guinea, where the tribal society has no structure which is inherited. Basically, the leaders have to build their reputation themselves. It doesn't help that they are born to certain families, and there is also traditionally no police or other structures which would simply could be used to build a large political units. And so people have to really build them from below up, and So they will very soon hit the limits of their leadership, and for the large units, they will tend to fragment with the challengers for leadership emerging all the time. So that, I think, is a very sensible explanation for fragmented nature of Papua New Guinea. Although I have to say that 150 people is probably underestimating the social prowess of Papua New Guineans, because you have to think about first extended families and how they socialized in that context, and then comes the politics. I just realized the size of the problem from one of my students who was saying, well, I'm under big pressure from my family. I thought, well, that's of course everybody student says that. But then he explained me his particular circumstances. His father died early, and so his mother married again. He had a stepfather, and so between stepfather and father and mother, he had 9 grandparents, because his grandfather from father's side had 2 wives, and from mother's side had 3 wives. So these grandparents produced 35 aunts and uncles, and they have currently 137 cousins. So he has to actively deal with what is still in New Guinea seen as a close family. That means 137 cousins, their partners, then, of course, there are the whole level of schoolmates, tribal partners, and then we go to the politics. And so probably 150 is a serious underestimation in New Guinea, but that that conclusion is still valid, that there is a very, very low limit to how many people you can meaningfully recruit into political units on the tribal level. That led to extreme fragmentation. This is the population distribution of different languages as of year 2000 in New Guinea, where this is on logarithmic scale. So that means there is a log normal distribution, technically speaking, where after we log transform data, we get such a nice bell curve here, where in the middle of that curve, that's about 1,000 population size. And so there is a mean size of a language population at 1,100 people. Very much similar pattern is when we measure the square kilometers occupied by languages rather than population sizes. And so the size of the language is the typically 540 square kilometers. And we have half of all languages have somewhere between 350 and 3,000 speakers. So extremely low population sizes. And that's actually the situation 20 years ago, after already very significant increase in population size. This is the population size of Papua New Guinea in the year 2000, which was 5 million people. And so we have to keep in mind that just 30 years ago, 1970, it was half of that. And so all these numbers would be even lower. So there is an extreme ability of languages to survive even at small population size. The fact that their sizes is log normal distributed is not surprising. If we start a very simple model with equal population sizes for different languages, like example of these 5, and then we apply different rate of growth, which is normally distributed, which means that some environments are marginally more favorable, some marginally less favorable. That could be diseases, soil fertility, and so on. And so if we apply this rate of growth, then on a uniform distribution, we will get a log normal distribution of population sizes after generations. And that's exactly what we have in reality in Papua New Guinea. But how it actually happened, how the individual languages or tribes fragment, we can model that in different ways. We can assume that whether a certain language shown here on this map fragments into 2 or not, either depends on the size of that language already. So that means bigger ones are more likely to fragment, or is independent of the size. And then how the fragmentation happened? Is it more or less split into 2 halves, or is it extremely asymmetric with a small with a small fractions leaving the large part. We can play with this in different models. This is example where the split is independent on the size of the language, and it happens in 1-to-3 ratio. So there is an asymmetry, but not extreme. That results on a quite different, much more broader distribution of population sizes for New Guinea languages, a lot of very small languages, and also some very large. So that doesn't work. The equal half and half split again leads to a different distribution than we observe. This is so-called broken stick model that's used for modeling biological niches, and that means that the split is completely random. So we simply draw randomly a line across the language area, and the bigger language, the more likely it is to split. Again, the distribution this time has some really large numbers of bigger languages than we actually observed. So the actual observed one fits closely log normal, but can be easily modeled by any of these models. It looks like there is a really simply a strong filter preventing languages from becoming too small. They simply go extinct, or from too large, and that is the social fragmentation. Now, when we have a lot of species in the tropics, we often get some bizarre ones. We get birds of paradise in New Guinea. We get huge huge butterflies, huge moths there. It's simply a matter of numbers that with so many numbers, you can have some really strange, biologically unique organisms. The same goes with the languages. If you have 800 languages, you can expect some with very peculiar features. And there has been some recorded. So for instance, this is Yupno language in the Finisterre Mountains, where it has been relatively recently, less than 10 years ago, discovered by linguists and published that while people in almost everywhere else speak about future and place future in front of them and place past at the back of them, and that can be proven by monitoring their body language when they speak about future and past, people in Yupno have actually one specific forest area where they place past and one different area where they place future. And if they talk about past and future, they subconsciously point to these locations. They remain geographically oriented, and as long as they are outdoors, they will point to these areas. Another interesting feature is mathematical systems. Of course, mathematics is a universal phenomenon, but lots of small tribes have not really developed counting systems very far. It's one, two, or too many. But there are a few which are using counting systems of a different type than the decimal systems, which is based widely elsewhere, and which basically is counting fingers on both hands. You can count the body parts, but when you think about it, there is absolutely no reason why it have to be 10 fingers. It can be completely different array of body parts and different number of body parts, and that's indeed what's happening in some of the languages. So about 15% of New Guinea languages have this counting system based on body parts. There is the map where they are found in red, and then the base of the numerical system, which means how many body parts they are actually counting, differs between languages and ranges in this study from 12 to 75. Interestingly, the odd numbers are twice as frequent as even bases. So 10 is unusual in that regard as an even base. Why is that? Well, one explanation is that if you have an odd base, that you get a special number which is splitting your base exactly in two. So for instance, if you have base of 13, then you have six numbers, then number seven is the middle one, and then you have additional six numbers on the higher side. And so the the body part, which signifies number seven, can have a special position. That special position can be nose, which was found in the highest number of languages, sternum, and potentially some others. So, for instance, again, Yupno language has a numerical base of 33. And so when you look at how they count, then they start with fingers, but then they move to toes, and then they move further to ears, and then other parts on the head, and then finally they demonstrate that mathematics is basically a matter for males. They have the base of 33, but in this case they would have a special number 17, and that does not happen. 17 is a random toe, so does not have any kind of center position. This is Mount Bosavi, an extinct volcano coming out from the lowland, very spectacular landscape feature, and there are a number of languages centered on that mountain, and there are some examples. Each of them have different way of counting based on body parts and different bases. So that shows enormous diversity, which is, however, partly undocumented. Last interesting feature I would mention are taboo languages. This is a feature which we also have in some European languages, for instance, where some of the expressions were taboo, and in the popular literature as well, Lord Voldemort, for instance. But that phenomenon was much more extensive in some New Guinea languages, where when it came to the season of harvesting pandanus nuts. Pandanus is an edible plant. You can see it here planted around the village in the Finisterre Mountains, but there are documents about pandanus being also collected, the wild pandanus being collected before the invention of agriculture in New Guinea several thousand years ago. Nowadays, it's purposefully planted, and when there is a season to harvest edible nuts, then the village leaves for their pandanus fields, and in order not to spoil the next harvest and in order to placate the forest spirits, there is a number of words which can't be used in their usual form and has to be replaced by secret pandanus language. And in some languages, these come to several hundreds expressions. So people suddenly start talking essentially different language when they're harvesting pandanus. Then they come back to the village and switch back to their normal language. Now, of course, these languages are also conduit for the accumulated information from the past, including ethnobiological information. So this is, for instance, 483 names for the iconic bird cassowary, which is actually the largest native species of animal in New Guinea. No mammal is bigger than it, and so it's very prominent in the lore and in the lives of New Guineans, and so every language has a name for it. This is the Trans-New Guinea languages naming cassowary. Perhaps the most famous ethnobiology book in New Guinea and perhaps globally is Birds of My Kalam Country, written by Ralph Bulmer, a New Zealand anthropologist, together with his local informer Siam Mainet. Siam was recruited by Ralph when he was a teenager. There is his photo when he started working with Ralph, and there is nothing unusual of having informants like that. But in this collaboration, that became much more equitable, where Siam, he finally got a honorary doctorate from the University of Papua New Guinea. You can see him here with Ralph Bulmer again. And then he had a much more structured input into the whole design of the book, how not only what's the knowledge about individual species, but how these species are seen and interpreted by Kalam culture. Unfortunately, Ralph Bulmer died relatively early from brain cancer, and then Siam Mainet died a few years ago, although I was lucky to visit him in his village and knew him personally. So these Birds of Kalam Country, it's a bilingual book where on every page you have the Kalam and English text, and It shows the Kalam taxonomy, where when you compare it with the modern bird taxonomy, 96 species are exactly the same. Then 21 Kalam names referred to a subset of biological species, for instance, one sex, although they of course knew which males belong to which females. Then in 13 cases, the Kalam names combined a group of related species, 6 cases unrelated species, and only 8 cases were going across the boundaries of the modern biological taxonomy. However, what is more interesting is the classification of birds, which completely departs from biology. Biology is, of course, based on the phylogenetic relationships, but Kalam taxonomy does not try to replicate that from their own knowledge. But it's a rather combination of ecological, mythological, and morphological features. So the main groups of birds are not bird families as we know them, but groups of birds which to which the souls of men can be reincarnated, souls of women, birds visiting blooming trees, birds visiting Pipterus trees, birds that swallow stones and crush them, that inhabit middle stories of trees, live on the ground in the open country, visit isolated trees, birds that continually fly, that fly above the water, birds that flying and are being active in the night, birds that vomit all they eat, which is of course bats, which are hanging upside down. Birds that are arriving during the dry season, birds from warm lowlands, and which is basically exotics because Kalam language is in the highlands, and yellow and red birds of paradise, birds that are birds of prey, basically eating other animals, and the cassowary as a special case. Now, lots of traditional knowledge is medicinal, and so there is currently a lot of interest into indigenous medicinal knowledge, and we will talk about it a little bit with the main message is that it's culturally interesting, it's very valuable, but it tends to be medicinally wrong. And the reason for that are small populations. If we have hundreds of people speaking the same language, then that means there is a very low replication for any rare disease. Then the lack of written record, and so that means very poor transfer of knowledge between generations, especially in small communities. And then also prominent role of healers. That means much bigger placebo effect than we are experiencing from our medical profession we know in the modern countries. We have surveyed 8 locations in lowland rainforest, primarily for biology, but we have also recorded the use of plants. And while across these 500 kilometers of uniform lowland rainforest, we found that people were using the same plant species consistently for instance, baskets, like Nitum Nemon here, then for medicinal use, often the same plant species was used for completely different purposes and ailments at each community, which of course does not add confidence to the medical basis of such treatment. There has been recently an interesting survey of plant use in New Guinea, and individual plant species were recorded as treating broader groups of illnesses. And despite that robust analysis, 84% of all specific use of certain plant for certain class of illnesses were unique. That means they were only reported in one language. Again, that is a bit of disconcerting when we think about the medical basis of such use, because we would expect that for the plant species shared between different languages, the use of them will converge on the same set of illnesses. For instance, when we have two languages where they have different, partly different floras in their area, let's assume that the ailments they suffer are exactly the same. And then we can have uses of particular plant species for particular illness, which differ between two languages because the plants involved differ. So this is example of such element that's basically biological turnover, which is causing the unique uses. And in this database of New Guinea, plant uses that responded to about 42% of interactions. Then there is a situation where we have the same plant species, but used to treat a different illness at each language. That was another 42% of uses, and only 16% were for the shared plant species used for the same purpose in both languages. The reason why a medical knowledge does not really reflect efficient treatments is simply that that knowledge is very difficult to obtain and maintain in small communities. This is a Central European settlement where we can see the division of population to the sizes of typical New Guinea language groups. So we can imagine that the entire wealth of medical information for plant use would have to be maintained across generations by people within the delimited areas. And that, of course, already demonstrates the problem of maintaining any more sophisticated information. So these are reasons why medical knowledge is not always based on the real treatment. Basically, we are saying, for instance, Google Scholar has it as its motto that we stand on the shoulders of giants in science, and that was a pronouncement by Isaac Newton. And it's true that in science we take the best achievements of each generation and accumulate them into the body of international science. Unfortunately, oral knowledge transfer in tribal societies makes this system very inefficient, because we can say that these societies are standing on the shoulders of dwarfs. It's the worst generation in that small society, lacking any talented people, which can cause a huge amount of information being lost between generations. And so that's a very important reason why medical systems of tribal societies typically work as placebos. That is opposed to the recent unrealistic expectations about bioprospecting, the fact that some of these tribal knowledge might actually guide modern medicine in searching for pharmaceuticals. There is no question that a hugely diverse plant communities of tropical countries with their diverse chemistry do include a lots of unexplored chemicals with potential medical benefits, but very little of that can be learned from the tribal knowledge. Even without using tribal knowledge, the bioprospecting has its problems because it's a very inefficient way of finding the medications. Despite of that, there has been a political movement which led to so-called Nagoya Protocol. The full name is Nagoya Protocol on Access to Genetic Resources and the Fair and Equitable Sharing of Benefits Arising from their Utilization to the Convention of Biological Diversity. So the treaty is as bad as the and bureaucratic as the title suggests. First, It is outdated. It's focusing on genes and DNA. That's the mindset from the 20 years ago when there was some specific consideration about information in DNA. Nowadays, the whole biology is basically DNA biology. So there is absolutely no difference between whether knowledge comes from DNA or not. Secondly, it is setting up as a precautionary principle that there has to be benefit sharing agreements for any kind of research, no matter whether it's likely to produce a commercial outcome or not. That of course sets very unrealistic expectations. That also makes the commercial companies to avoid this kind of research for the reputational and political risks. And overall, it really makes a big problems for biological research and harms the collaboration between tropical and developed countries because of the unreasonable expectations of Nagoya Protocol, even for exploratory research, which has nothing to do with commercial applications. For instance, this is the group of postgraduate students of biology in the Czech Republic, master's and PhD level students who are all working on biological diversity from Papua New Guinea. And you can see the entire maze of freezers at our department, which contain specimens from New Guinea, and the students are based their study on these specimens. This could be almost impossible to work under Nagoya Protocol. And so the end result of that good intentional agreement would be that all these students will either have no chance to come to do their studies, or they would be forced, instead of studying biodiversity of their own country, where that knowledge is really needed and their expertise should focus on, they would have to study boring biodiversity of their European surroundings. So this is just Nagoya Protocol is an example of complete political incompetence of scientists and of the usual process of good intentions leading to hell. Now, we have also discussed about the diversity of languages in tropical countries with some parallels to diversity of plants and animals. And we know that plants and animals are extremely poorly known in tropical countries. And so the question is, what about languages? How well documented they are? Surprisingly, somewhat surprisingly to me at least, the situation is even worse than for biological diversity. While there is a very intense research on biological diversity, the documentation of cultures and languages is lagging behind that. So for instance, from the 850 languages in New Guinea, for some of them, there is virtually no information recorded. And when it comes to a proper dictionary with not only listing terms, but also explaining them, basically thesaurus in that language, there are extremely few of them. I know only the dictionary of Kalam, which was put together by Andrew Pauly, a PhD student of Ralph Bulmer, and published recently also with a number of local informants, including Sam Minet. That is an amazing piece of work where individual words are explained in cultural context. So when we just randomly open at a page, then for instance, there is a term for sexual intercourse, and there is a conversational sentence used in that context in the Kalam language and also translated. A certain woman who was a witch and a normal woman had sexual relations, and the witch took the witch demon inside her and transferred it to the other woman. So that's a conversational sentence where women can converse like that when doing laundry or cooking, for instance. Interestingly, the largest language documentation project is Christianity's attempt to translate Bible to all the languages of the world. Here is how they are doing, and there is a lot of activity in Papua New Guinea. So there is an example of three such local translations. The first page of Matthew for comparison, and of course, the results are widely different, whether depending on whether motivation for such a huge project as translation of the Bible is mostly religious or mostly linguistic, and individual translators greatly differ in this motivation. There is also a study showing that only about 1/3 of such translations are actually routinely used by people speaking the language, and that again might reflect the quality of the translation. Also, not only languages, but also the traditional uses of plants and the traditional knowledge of animals and plants remain poorly documented. There is a survey of New Guinea uses of plants by Kamara Leret and Denehi recently published, which is listing almost 20,000 individual plant uses for 217 indigenous groups. That sounds impressive, but only 2.5% of New Guinea cultural groups have more than 100 plant uses recorded. Interestingly, we also see a dynamic of research where there was a much more intense research in Papua New Guinea between the independence 1975 and year 2000, while now after year 2000, the activity shifted mostly to the Indonesian part of the island. But when we look at some well-documented indigenous groups, one of them is again Kalam, where Rhys Gardner, again working with Siam Mainep, here you can see them on the photo, documented and published about 500 different plant uses for Kalam. Assuming this is a typical situation for each of the approximately 1,000 indigenous groups in New Guinea, we would expect to have 500,000 specific plant uses. That means certain plant and certain use in certain language. And with that number, the 20,000 of documented uses suddenly looks much less impressive. And that's what is currently documented from the whole information, which is being lost at a fast rate, unfortunately. What is the current situation with languages and ethnobiological knowledge was the subject of our research, which was led by Alfred Kick, PhD student at the University of South Bohemia and Biology Center of the Czech Academy of Sciences. Alfred has a background in ethnobiology, and so he embarked on a large-scale testing of secondary school students, administering tests of their language skills and collecting their background information on their social and economic situation. This was originally a master project, which really escalated due to an enormous interest of schools and students and excellent collaboration of also Department of Department of Education, headmasters and everybody else. So finally, we have been able to survey 6,190 students. You can see the completed questionnaires ready for databasing, and they represented speakers of 392 languages, so approximately half of all Papua New Guinea languages. That study has been published in May 2021 in Proceedings of National Academy of Science as a paper led by Alfred and including a number of collaborators. And the title says it all: language and ethnobiological skills decline precipitously in Papua New Guinea, the world's most linguistically diverse nation. This is how the surveys took place. This is Mount Hagen School, where you can directly see more than 400 students speaking 37 different languages. They were given the test naming different body parts from easy to more difficult ones in their native language. They also had to recognize 10 bird species and list 10 plant uses, and also self-assess their language fluency and provide information on their social background. So this study seems to be straightforward, but there were a lot of problems in interpreting the data. For instance, somewhat unexpectedly for somebody who is not living in New Guinea, it can be very difficult to find out from the questionnaire what language is actually the student speaking. We of course asked about it, but how people call the language is not necessarily the same as linguists call the languages. There is an ethnologue system of language codes, free letters, and listing the languages of the world. And there is also glottologue taxonomy. But of course, neither of them could coincide with what people are using in the field. There is also a difference between language and dialect, which may not be the same between databases and how the language is perceived in the field. Also, languages are still being described. This is Wanang community. This is a conservation, rainforest conservation community, which works with us. And only recently in 2016, their language was newly differentiated and recognized as an independent language from what was originally seen as a dialect. Of course, this is completely academic exercise, which was published in Oceanic Linguistics, but has nothing to do with people on the ground. And if it were not for our collaboration, they would never actually even learn that that the status of their language officially changed. So finding out what language people speak is difficult. Sometimes we had to look at the place they were born. That is another difficulty because the name of the village may differ from what is on the maps. The location of the villages is changing. How they are called is changing. So even that was not always very clear. And then when they were naming the body parts, then we have to remember that even good speakers of the language are typically not writing in that language. The transfer of languages is by and large completely oral, and so suddenly asking somebody to write down in their native indigenous language might be very difficult. And so, for instance, in one of the languages, Melpa, this is the question about how to say I. And then, although there is a consistency with just two spelling accounting for a majority of cases, there was 94 different other ways how to spell I in the Melpa language. And so this just illustrates the difficulty of assessing the results. Now, since we had such a large group of secondary students, we can also ask what can we tell about the students socially. First, these were the last 2 years of secondary school, and that made these students to be high flyers already, because when you look at the education of their parents, then by reaching the end of secondary school, they have already achieved a higher education level than 60% of their fathers and 80% of their mothers. They also are coming from large families. They typically have five siblings, and only 1.6% of students had no siblings at all. So any psychological problems from being the only child is pretty much non-existent in New Guinea schools, although there might be some other psychological problems of coming from families with too many siblings. The families the students are coming from typically own agricultural land. 95% of families, that's typical for New Guinea at large. More than half own rainforest, which is quite interesting for us as biologists, but only half of them have electricity at home. 60% are coming from the village, and then 80% of them can reach their home by road, while there are also 13% where they have to walk long distance to reach their permanent address. When we look at the demography compared with United Kingdom as a typical European country, then the age cohort of secondary students in New Guinea is the largest one. All the older ones are smaller, so these students have basically sort of empty field ahead of them. But of course, there will be pressure from even more numerous younger cohorts, unlike the students in the UK, where all the good positions are, you know, have been taken by the older, more numerous generations ahead of them. Now, what was the results of language fluency as assessed by students themselves? We expected, of course, some decline between parents and students, but it was bigger than we expected. First, mothers and fathers speak very fluently. There was more than 90% of them were rated by their children, by the students as fluent. But then there was only about 60% of students themselves rating as fluent. So there was a significant decline, which can't be attributed to colonial history. This is all very recent events between two still living generations. So we have to look at globalization and modern changes in the lifestyle to explain it. Another issue here is that we selected secondary students, but we have to keep in mind that this is a very biased sample of the entire population. There are only 15% of the young generation that finishes secondary school, and this is a very non-random selection. They are mostly coming from towns. You can see that our students were 35% coming from towns as compared to only 12% in general population. Their parents are much more educated. Several times a higher percentage had at least some tertiary education compared to the general population. And also twice as many parents have some cash income compared to general population, where lots of families are relying on subsistence agriculture. So, however, we have within our study of students, we have differences between students coming from the village and from town in their language fluency. We have differences associated with parents' education and income, and so we could have modeled all these effects, and that led to a correction. This is the fluency of indigenous language for the parents. This is what we actually measured for the students, and this is our correction. That's what we extrapolated for entire population, correcting some of these biases of selecting secondary school students. Now, we also were able to, because we have 6,000 data points, we were able to do fairly sophisticated analysis of multiple factors, how they affect fluency of language. So we were looking at the family language use. The height of the column indicates the size of the effect on the fluency of students. The home use, not surprisingly, was very important, whether indigenous language was used or whether only Neo-Melanesian Pidgin or English were used. But then also another important factor was whether the parents were speaking the same language or whether they were forming a linguistically mixed family. Of course, that influenced the use of the language at home, but this is this analysis shows the impact apart from the use of the home language. So this is an independent additional factor. And then the actual fluency of parents had a very small effect on the fluency of students, simply because most of the parents were fluent, so there was not big variability in this factor. When we look at the social economic factors, then urbanization, whether a student was living in their young age in village or town and city, had the main effect. And then the remoteness of the location was secondary, while the education and cash income of parents had a significant but smaller effect, apart from urbanization. Of course, there was a big connection between the education of parents and their ability to live in town as compared to the village. We also studied student traits. The traditional skills of students were positively correlated with their language skills. The traditional skills included hunting, fishing, traditional house building, farming, and use of medicinal plants. Also, modern skills, use of computer and mobile phone, were negatively correlated with their language skills. Interestingly, there were no differences in fluency in language between males and females, and also no connection with their English and mathematical results at school. And finally, language traits. Whether language was classified as endangered or not did show difference in how the students were doing with that language. So that classification was verified, and also some of the geographic areas had a different level of language fluency. That was probably due to some factors, either economical or social, which we did not catch in our analysis. On the other hand, interestingly, population size of the languages did not have any effect, which was unexpected. And then also the Bible translation, whether available or not for a given language, and the elevation where the language was located, they were not significant factors. Now, when we look at the interesting issue of the mixed families, then we had for our students, 63% were coming from families where both parents spoke the same language, and 37 were already mixed. In the completely panmictic population, where people find their partners in complete disregard for their language across the whole Papua New Guinea, we would expect only 1% of linguistically uniform families. Of course, that's a very unrealistic expectation. But we have also asked students at school whether their best friend is speaking the same language or not as themselves. And there were 65% of students with speaking different language than their best friend. That was already not very far from completely random selection of friends, which would at a given school resulted in 77% of best friends with different languages. So it looks like at least friendships are initiated pretty much without regard to languages, and we can expect the same with these students when they are choosing their partner. And so it's likely that the mixed language families will increase in the next generation with further negative effect on fluency of their children. One of the modern impacts which we have not studied, but which is potentially important, is mobile phones. Mobile phone coverage extends to some remote areas where it is pretty much the only technological change in the last 40 years, when there are still no electricity, there are still no roads, but suddenly there is access to internet and to mobile phones and to other people in Papua New Guinea. And that probably further strengthens the prominence of Pidgin English and English as opposed to the native language. So at the same time, this connection to the outside world is extremely welcome. And so there is a real demand for this broader communication. When speaking about the urbanization is another important factor, Papua New Guinea is very unusual in that regard. Globally, now more than half of the humanity is living in towns and cities as opposed to villages, and the trend is clear in all countries pretty much. There is an increasing urbanization, except for Papua New Guinea, which keeps the proportion of people living in the villages steady and at a very, very high percentage. So there is one of the lowest urbanization in the world, which relates to the traditional land ownership. If you move to town and stay there permanently, then your relatives are likely to take over your land, and you can lose your land ownership rights, which of course are very valuable. So that's probably the main driver of continued rural lifestyle, where Papua New Guinea is one of the most extreme countries in that regard at the moment. But when we look at the extrapolation of the urbanization trends, then in 2050, Papua New Guinea will be one of the handful of countries where a majority of population will still be living in the village rather than in town or city. The remoteness and road connection, another aspect which is influencing languages, again, it's a big topic in Papua New Guinea, where everybody wants to have road connections. There are basically very, very few tribes who would wish to remain isolated, and the building of road network is one of the main political wishes and political promises in Papua New Guinea. There is no wonder about that, because living away from road is causing large financial difficulties. For instance, coffee growers lose 50% of their income if they have to send their coffee beans by air instead of by road. And also our inputs to the village, all the trade goods are much more expensive if they have to be brought by either on foot or by air instead of by road. So there is a very strong pressure to improve connection, and that means impact on languages. This is an example of a remote community in the Finisterre Mountains with airstrip and school. And when anthropologist Hubeniáková and Soukup asked the students at school to draw how they see the future of their village, in all cases, there was some kind of road and cars, although the students, some of them have never seen a real car in their life. But there was road always, and very often also mobile phone communication tower. So there is a real need to get a connection. It's building of the roads, although very poor ones, is one of the main incentive for people to agree to logging of their forests. And this is an example of the community celebration of start of building a road as a sort of political donation. So there is a very strong pressure to connect people. Now, when we go to connecting language skills with the life skills, unfortunately, we could not compare them with the skills of their parents or the students. We only ask to self-assess whether a given skill is mastered well, a little or not at all. And we can see that, for instance, growing food, only 60% of students are confident they can do it very well, although we can be pretty sure that pretty much all of their parents were excellent or are still excellent at growing food. Treating fever with plants, much less confidence. Further, house building, that might still change when the students are getting older. But interestingly, hunting is the least mastered traditional skills from those which we studied. Looks like the social prestige of hunting is diminishing, and it's more computer use than hunting, which makes for a desirable skill. Now, which languages are endangered? Obviously, when we look at the population density distribution, then we can say that no matter how languages are sensitive to small population, if you have less than 100 speakers, the language is in problems. When we look at the different endangerment classifications, then some of them are looking only at the transfer between generations. Some of them also incorporate population size. In our study, we separated these two factors, and the classification of generational transfer did show correlation with the language skills of the students, while population size did not. For instance, Sutherland some years ago applied the IUCN Red List classification of endangered animal species on languages that combines population trends and population size, and concluded that it's actually a higher percentage of languages than mammals or birds that are endangered. When it comes to ethnobiological knowledge, not surprisingly, in our analysis, the key factor was the language skills. Students losing language were very poor at recognizing birds and listing plant uses. When we analyzed all the social economic factors except language skills, then we got a very similar picture of the importance of different factors as when we analyzed the language skills. With traditional skills, urbanization, very important for bird recognition. One difference was also importance of gender. Male students were much better in recognizing birds, probably because they were also better at hunting than girls. For plant uses, again, urbanization, traditional skills, and also the use of the language at home were the main factors. When you want to be a good ornithologist, then based on our results, you also tend to be rather poor at using computer. And also, if your parents are highly educated, that you are very unlikely to know your birds well. So these are some of the correlations. For the use of plants, the indigenous languages, use of plants was dominated by medicinal uses. Then there was a large part which were not further specified. And the next most important use was sorcery. That was when students were able to list their plants in their native language. Some of the students could not do it. And so they instead use Pidgin English or English. And that data set was analyzed separately. And there the medicinal use is even more prominent. But when we actually look at what plants were listed, we found that the entire usage was dominated by only 10 plants, which represented more than 3/4 of all the usage. And these 10 plants were a common, widespread, globalized list with only 2 native plants and 8 introduced ones. And so the knowledge of these students who already lost their indigenous language was really not a local knowledge of plants, but included papaya, citrus, aloe vera, guayaba, lemongrass, and only 2 common native plants, Laportea and Morinda citrifolia. So to conclude, we are seeing profound changes in the ethnobiological and language skills. These are driven by changes in the society. This is documentation of cultural show bringing tens of different tribes with their traditional ceremonies from the highlands to Goroka, the local center, for Goroka show in 1957 and 1958. That was the idea of the then colonial power, Australia, which, however, grew extremely popular with the Papua New Guinea population. Papua New Guineans themselves were fascinated about the traditions and customs and rituals of others because they had no idea. During the pre-colonial times, and we have to keep in mind that in the highlands they extended all the way to 1930s and in some cases to 1950s. So many people on these photographs, they still remembered times when they had no idea about the surrounding world, about the fact that they were on an island, and about the colonial powers coming. So this is a relatively fresh experience, and before that, because of the tribal conflicts, nobody could freely travel across New Guinea. It took Sweet Potato, extremely useful introduction, 300 years to come from the coast, 250 kilometers inland. And so there was the information and goods were spreading extremely slowly. And no Papua New Guinean had any idea that there are 800 different languages on the island where they are living on. They typically knew only a couple of them from the neighbors. And so that diversity was protected by this inability to interact and move. And the end of the these tribal wars and conflicts still during the colonial period of time, which freed the travel across New Guinea. That's the main factor which initiated the demise of the languages. So we are living in a very special period of time where we can still see all these languages and traditions. But at the same time, the very fact that we can see them and observe them is also destroying them. It's a simple ability of Papua New Guineans to travel across their own country, which is the main factor interfering with maintenance of these languages. And of course, then all the effects of globalization. This tradition of cultural shows continues to the current date. This is from a few years ago. You can see clearly that this is not driven by international tourism. This is driven by local population. People are still very much interested in these traditions, but at the same time, the desire for development as defined by globalization, cash economy, transport, and urbanization is directly interfering with maintenance of these languages because they are suddenly not practical in that situation of a single nation, since you need communication which is more universal. When we ask students whether they plan to teach their children native language or not, then most of them said yes. Some of them said no because they did not feel competent to do so because they already lost a big part of the language. But from those who were sufficiently fluent, then 88% said yes, they plan to do so. But when we ask why, then a huge majority justified it by cultural reasons rather than the reasons of practical communication, which of course is perfectly okay. That's perfectly fine, but this intention will be facing very important pressures from society. This is, I will finish with this photograph of a newly graduating medical doctor with his father, both proudly in their traditional attire at the University of Papua New Guinea. So I think there is, to conclude, there is a hope of survival of at least big part of the languages and traditions, but it will be in spite of the societal pressure rather than along with the trends which we see. Finally, I would thank to our staff and New Guinea Binatang Research Center, which hosted the research and contributed informally to lots of this research, and also to colleagues, they are all authors of the paper I mentioned, as well as to 6,000 of students and 30 headmasters and all other teachers who helped this research. Thank you for your attention.